peace tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I may appreciate the Lord. I may love you tonight. Thank you, Jesus. God, we praise you tonight. Lord, we give you all of our worship tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All your worship. Welcome you to our service. Lord, don't we appreciate him tonight? Amen. Amen. God is good. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Ask him to bless the service tonight. Touch those that are not here for whatever reason. In Jesus' name, would you pray with me? Father, we're so thankful tonight, Lord, for all that you've done for us. We thank you, God, for your goodness. We praise you tonight, Lord, for your love. We ask that you minister to those that are not here, that seek in their bodies, Lord. God, that you touch each one of them and touch this service tonight and anoint it and use it in Jesus' name. Amen. Sister Creasy, come right on. Lead the service and you worship the Lord with her as she sings.
Beautiful message in this song that says, when morning comes, help us sing it tonight.
Try and start for every day that we cannot understand. All the ways that God will lead us to that blessed promised land. But if God is with us all, and we'll follow till we die, we will understand it better by
sounded so good. You all were doing great on that music over there. And I'll just tell you right now, Amen. Before we're all seated tonight, we got a call. Sister Betty and Brother Joey needing prayer tonight. Also, I understand Brother Norton was in an accident this afternoon. He's at the hospital getting checked out, so we want to lift him up in prayer. Also, we want to continue to remember Sister Duke. Amen. Keeping her in our prayers. And let's see. I'm trying to think of other requests that I know. I know Sister Wanda and Sister Sue have got two cousins. Is that right? That are in desperate need of God to move in their life. Maybe you've got a special request you'd like to be made known, Brother Zavala.
My uncle passed away yesterday, so remember my Aunt Lola and her family.
All right. Let's remember that family in prayer tonight. Any other spoken needs tonight? Yes, Little Britain Pool. We need to keep him in our prayers. And Sister Loretta needs our prayer, too. We want to keep her in prayer tonight. Maybe you've got an unspoken request. You just want to lift your hand up. Amen. God sees these needs. Sister Teresa, did you have a need?
Megan's dad's in the hospital.
All right. Let's pray for that need. Let's take these to the throne in prayer. Pastor, will you lead us? Let everybody pray.
Dear Jesus, we're grateful tonight.
Heavenly Father, Lord, it's grace, God, that we were going to be praying, Lord, for our friends, Lord, our brother and sister, Lord, brother and sister battling. God, they need a healing touch in their body, God. Lord, opposition has come their way, but God, I know that there's a name that's above every name. Lord, we want to pray, God, a prayer, God, that would cause them to be made whole in Jesus' name. Lord, we want to pray, God, for Brother Norton tonight that all is well. We pray, God, for Sister Duke, Lord, for a miracle healing in her body. Lord, we pray for Sister Loretta, Lord, for healing. Lord, we pray, God, for Sister Sue's and Sister King's cousins, Lord, that need a desperate move of God in their life. God, we pray for that healing touch. Lord, we pray for Brother Zavala's family, Lord, that's lost that loved one. God, we pray for healing tonight for those that are hurting, those that are sick. Most of all, we pray for salvation for the lost souls. So many wandering out and seeing. Oh, God, I pray, Lord, that you would call them, Lord, to come to an old rugged cross and be saved. Lord, we pray for Little Britain tonight, God, for a miracle healing in his body. Lord, touch every need that's in this place tonight. Lord, Megan's dad needs a healing touch. Lord, most of all, God, if there's a lost soul, Lord, in this place tonight. Lord, I pray for salvation, Lord, would come to their house tonight. In Jesus' name, let's clap our hands unto the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord bless you. Amen. Beck, if you will play a chorus in just a moment, we'll ask our ushers to come and we'll receive our evening offering. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. You give us unto the Lord, and the Lord will bless you. Amen. Brother Jack, would you pray? Amen, amen. Oh,
in the midnight hours, and the Lord has heard. Amen. Our children, they grew up with the name of Jesus being called many, many times. If I said Jesus, they'd say, Mama, what's wrong? Because that was the name that we were used to calling on, Brother Alderman. Amen. Because we know that Jesus is the salvation name. It's the healing name. Everything that we need is in Jesus tonight. And I'm so thankful that I know Him. Hallelujah. Praise God. Brother Posey, come right on and sing unto the Lord tonight. Amen. As you worship the Lord.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Now, I'm going to try singing this song. I haven't sang for a while because it's really true, and it really saved my wife and child today because He does have everything in control.
Amen. Yes, sir.
Be of good courage, I heard the master call. Put your life in my hands, said I don't know. Every situation, every trial, every test, give it all to me and I'll give you. He's got it all in control from beginning to the end. And no one knows like Jesus where you're going, where you've been. He's the one that made us see the driving north, cross over the river and headed up through Rotterdam. I can't remember exactly where it's at, but somewhere, I believe on the left, right after you pass the park area, there on there where you park, on your right, is a sign out there on the road that says, God has it all in control. Remember that? God, I know y'all think of that. And I was reading that one day and I thought, and how true it is that God does have everything in control. But I thought, I wonder how long they're going to let that sign stay. Wonder when some dingbat is going to come along and say, that sign offends me. It probably will happen. But until then, even if they take the sign down, that don't change God at all. He's still got all in control. Praise the Lord. The book of James, chapter 1. Going to do some more teaching. The Lord will let me, or allow me to. And I know last week, I believe it was, I taught on how to live as a Christian.
Right.
And I thought it was good.
Yes, sir.
And I'm probably going to refer back to some of that tonight, maybe kind of part two of the same kind of text-like thing. You know, I skipped that class, what to call it. But we'll see what the Lord's got for us. James chapter 1, verse 12. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he's tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. Now here's the good part, or here's the important part. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then, when lust is conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, bringeth forth death. I want to teach tonight the will to overcome temptation. The will to overcome temptation. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands and ask God's anointing. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you tonight. God, for the opportunity to be in this service tonight, Lord. God, thank you for the word of the Lord been read to our hearing. Bless tonight, God, for the next little while. God, bless the ministry and bless the saints of God. Anoint tonight, Lord. Use us for your glory. Let us leave here tonight, Lord, changed with a different attitude. God. In Jesus' name. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
You can be seated. One thing about temptation, it's like anything else. You have to have a made up mind. If you're going to overcome. If you don't have a made up mind, then you are wasting your time. You have to, if you're going to quit a habit, you pray. I read in one of our articles, in one of our magazines, a sister was writing an article, and she was mentioning lust. And she said that you have to repent, ask God's forgiveness, and then you got to work at it. You have to. And what she was actually saying was, you got to want to. You know, you cannot live for God if you don't want to. Nobody can force you. And the other side of that is, you can live for God if you want to, and nobody can stop you from living. They may hold a gun on you, not allow you to come to the house of God. They may not allow you to stand and worship, clap your hands and sing, but they cannot stop you from living for God.
Amen.
It's called a want to, a will to do it. Failure to overcome temptation can be a very big problem in our life. It can be devastating in our life to fail to overcome certain temptations in our life that we all go through every day. There's something that bothers us every day. And some are stronger than others. Some people are stronger than others. I've known people to quit smoking cigarettes after they've been smoking for years. I'm talking about 40 or 30 or 45, 35, 45 years. Quit smoking and wasn't even a Christian. They just made their mind up. They were going to quit. And they quit. But it takes a want to. Then I've seen Christians that tried to quit and probably eventually quit. I'm not saying that they didn't. But really had a battle with it. And some many times this lack of want to. The old devil just comes and he tempts. And he made me, when I was a young man, he would tell me things like, well, you're 21 years old, you can do what you want to do. And I'd agree with him. And it was called temptation. But till I made my mind up that I was gonna do it, I had a real battle with it. I'm not implying that I didn't have a battle after I quit the cigarettes. I'm not saying I didn't fight a battle, But I'm saying I never one time, and I can say this with all honesty, I never one time wanted to go back and pick them up. Never. Somebody said one time they had quit smoking and said after 20 years they could smoke one of them here to the road. Craving for it. But they never done it. They had their mind made up. Not going to do it. People have lost their jobs. Company executives have lost their positions because of temptation. Failing to overcome. Husbands have lost their wives and their families. Wives have lost their husbands and their families for failing to overcome certain temptations in their life. Many people do what they enjoy at the moment, not even thinking about what's the end result going to be. Or not even wondering about what's right or what's wrong. Just what makes me feel good, what I enjoy. If I enjoy it, it must be okay. That's what many people's mindset is. If it makes me feel good, then it must be all right. Not even thinking about what is morally right or morally wrong. They seek to satisfy the natural desire. It's got this natural desire. Some things now in that natural desire is not wrong. You know. I tell you what I really enjoy. It's called eating. I can look at y'all and tell y'all to. Y'all enjoy it.
Who are you looking at me
for? I enjoy eating. It's just a desire I have. I do it every day. Unless I'm fasting.
Breathe, brother.
And I would fast a whole lot more, somebody said, if I didn't get hungry. But when I fast, I get hungry.
Hey, when he talks about food.
But people will they seek that natural desire to sap. Or they seek to satisfy the natural desire. Whatever that might be. Not thinking about, is it okay or is it right or is it wrong? The James writer says when lust is conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, it bringeth forth death. Temptation is not a small thing. Temptation is not something to be overlooked. It's not something that we should just kindly sweep under the rug or sweep under the carpet. Temptation is very dangerous if it's left untaken care of, if I could use that way. If it's left not taken charge of or overcoming that temptation. It can destroy your plans in life. Temptation can. Temptation yielded to can take a life and totally destroy that life. It can destroy your plans for the future. It can destroy your hope. You know, certain things we have hope for, it can destroy our dreams. Dreaming of things. Our marriage, as I already said. And ultimately our soul is what temptation can do. If we let temptation alone and just kind of leave it unattended, it can take charge of our life. And before we know it, we can't even get away from it.
All right.
It's called temptation. Temptation is an emotional desire.
All right.
James said, but every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust. It's lust that it doesn't have to be a sexual lust. It can be lust for anything. And the writer said, when we're drawn away of our own lust and enticed. That is what temptation is. It's an emotional thing. I was talking about, you know, people get on this emotional kick. You know, what makes them feel good. That people have an ego. I said this the other day to someone, and I've said it all. I've said it ever since I've been, you know, preaching. I'm going to say it again tonight. I have talked with people, and most people that have young children, young boys particularly, maybe and some even young girls, that push them into sports.
Yeah.
It's an ego thing, and it's not the child's ego.
Right, right, right.
It's daddy's ego.
All right. All right.
I knew a man that had a son that didn't want to play baseball, didn't want to play t-ball, didn't want to play the coach pitch, and didn't want to play all this other, which there's nothing wrong with playing that sport. I'm not implying that. But he didn't want to play. He couldn't run. He had two messed up feet. He could hardly walk without stumbling. But Dad made him play ball. You know what it was? It was called ego. It was their ego. Dad's ego, not the boy's ego. Right. And people get this ego, like they get this desire. They get this thing about this thing that they have to please, this flesh, this desire that they got.
All right.
Praise the Lord. God didn't. God made a way for us as Christians. God has made a way. You know, we have always been accused or thought of as a organization or a denomination or whatever you want to call us. We've always been thought of as a group that doesn't believe in having fun. When I was in Savannah, pastoring there, there was a man and his two teenage boys and wife lived about two or three doors down from our church. Our church was actually sitting right in the middle of a subdivision. Roger, I believe you went out and visited that church or saw the church building, I believe you did. And it was out in the middle of like a subdivision. And so we would, I would walk around in the subdivision and talk with people sometimes until I found out I really wasn't pastoring that church. The people told me that. But I asked this guy to come to church, and I worked with him. We worked at Yellow Creek Nuclear Plant. He was a carpenter, I was a welder, and I was a welder in the crew that he was in, so we got a lot of talking time. And I always invited him to church. And he said, "Preacher, I can't bring my boys to your church." And I said, "Why?" He said, "Because you won't let them have any fun." I didn't have a clue what he was talking about. I have more fun than a barrel of monkeys. I have godly fun. I have a great time on Friday nights. If I don't take my sweetie out on Saturday, I take her out on Friday, I take her out on Saturday. We have a great time. When I come home, I know where my car's at. I don't have to have an eye-opener sitting down beside my bed to pop a top off and drink the next morning to get up. I have a lot of fun. God ordained it. God made a way for the church to enjoy life without being disobedient to Him. God made that way for us. He didn't give the Ten Commandments or the commandments to take away our freedom. The commandments are not designed to take away our freedom or to keep us from having fun. God set a moral and a spiritual law, set a set of moral and spiritual laws for our well-being,
right.
to help us.
Right.
Surgeon General said here 30 or 40 years ago, I don't know exactly the time, but some of you will remember when they started putting on the pack of cigarettes that this product can cause cancer. How many remembers that when it first started?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I remember way back before then, my pastor told me I shouldn't smoke cigarettes because it wasn't good for me. God was way ahead of the Surgeon General. Way ahead. God set a set of moral laws for my well-being, not to punish me. He told me not to commit adultery because some husband might blow your head off. Not good for you. Just simple stuff here tonight. He set a set of moral laws for my well-being, for it to do me good. God knows or knew that certain kind of behavior was harmful to you. God, I've had people tell me, well, smoking marijuana is different than taking hard drugs. No, it's not. It's just cheaper. It's not different. It messes up your liver. It messes up your body. It messes up your... Don't tell me, man. I don't smoke that junk. It messes up your thinking. Makes you feel like you can just whoop a gorilla. It's no different. God set laws for us. Somebody asked Charlie Mahaney. Most of you don't know Charlie Mahaney. Some of you do. He'd been here before, but not since most of y'all were here. asked him, said, Brother Mahaney was speaking something on some marijuana about talking about, you know, he used to smoke it, he was a drug addict. God delivered him. He was kind of teaching on the subject. And this one guy said, told him, said, I don't believe it's wrong to smoke marijuana. And he said, well, he said, God made marijuana. No. And said, if it was wrong, he wouldn't have made it.
Yeah.
Brother Mahaney said, well, he made poison ivy, too. But he didn't tell you to eat it. I got it all over my arm right now. I don't like it. God set a set of rules for us. For us to go by, that he knew certain things was harmful for us, so God placed them certain things off limits in our life. The problem is man's carnal nature. Our carnal nature causes us to just cast God's law to one side and satisfy the desire in our heart any way we can. That's God's law. That's what man has done with God's law. That ain't the Holy Ghost, y'all. That's a watch. Praise the Lord. Thank you, brothers. God. Temptation can destroy in one moment, what it has taken a lifetime to be. You understand? One moment. Was that the only one? That the only one? Okay. My spray didn't work, Roger. Sprayed it twice. Okay, let's get back to the teaching, the Word of God. As I was saying, temptation can destroy in one moment what has taken a lifetime to be. It can destroy a relationship that's taken 35, 40, 45, 50 years. To build. Temptation can destroy that in just a moment's time. There's several things I want to look at here quickly. I want to look at our character. Remember I talked a little bit about character last week? I talked a little bit about what character is and what reputation is and the difference between the two. I know you remember a person that has character will draw a line of how far to go. A person that has character. He will establish a boundary in his life. Certain things you just don't do. I know people, you know, that they got this whatever of we're living by grace and we're saved by grace and there's nothing you can do about it. Well, that's really just not scripture. That's just not scripture. The part about saved by grace is scripture. But that nothing we can do to change it is not scripture. There's boundaries. We have a person that's got character will set boundaries in their life. They'll set some things off limits to them. I don't party, not because I don't booze it up, not to make me saved. Grace has already made me saved. But I don't party and booze it up because I am saved. I have set me some boundaries in my life. I don't get out and do that. I don't go certain places. I don't go certain people I don't like to talk to. If a person's going to talk to me instead of using the Lord's name in vain, instead of using bad language and so forth and so on, I don't want to talk to them. I'll try my best not to be rude. I'll try not to hurt their feelings. But I'll find some way to make myself I have to have somewhere to go.
That's right.
I got to have boundaries in my life because of God's law that God has put in my life.
Amen.
A person that's got good character will have a sense of right and wrong.
Yes. Yeah.
You might not know a lot of things about the Word of God. There's things in the Word of God I don't know. I read it. But I ain't sure I understand it all. How many is that way?
All right. Yes.
But you will have a sense of right. I told you the other night, I believe it was last Wednesday night, I told you something about the Bible. Certain things the Bible does not really say.
Right.
But the principle is that.
All right.
It's a principle. It don't say you shall not go 150 miles an hour down the interstate the wrong way. But the principle of the fact is, if you do, you might not make it. That's just. And so a person with character, he knows what's right and he knows what's wrong, and you can't hem him up on it. Brother Dwayne Harry told me one time he was on a pipeline. And he was a preacher, before he started pastoring. And he was out there, on this bus going out to the job site. And he had his Bible, and this real rugged construction worker sitting beside him and said, "Say," he said, "are you a preacher or something?" And Brother Harry told him, "Yeah, he's a preacher." And he said, "What in the world are you doing in a place like this? If you're a preacher, what are you doing out here?" You know what he was saying was, "We're a bunch of idiots." "So what are you doing out here?" Brother Harry asked him, said, "Don't you know the Bible says we are to let our light shine?" He said, "Well, yeah." He said, "Well, do you know any place any darker than where we're at right now?
Come on, Pastor.
For my light to shine?"
Right.
And he told him something about, said the guy, they got to talking about, and said, "These guys got the cussing man using some terrible language." I mean, these construction workers do that.
Yeah,
they do. And talking bad, and said, Brother Harrison, he said, "How many did y'all say last night got the Holy Ghost?" So this guy looked at him and said, "What'd you say?" He said, "How many got the Holy Ghost in that service?" He said, "Preacher, ain't nobody said it about nobody getting no Holy Ghost." And Brother Harrison said, "Well, I must have misunderstood you." Turned around and walked away. Certain things has to be off limits to a Christian. Certain things that is evil at the very... Did you know the Bible said shun the very appearance of evil? Even if it seems to be wrong, get away from it. That's what the scripture teaches. Well, you're going to hurt somebody's feelings. No, you won't. Not if you do it the right way, you won't. And if it hurts somebody's feelings, it'll just have to hurt their feelings. You're not obligated. Character is not what one does when no one is watching. I mentioned this the other night. Character is what we do and what we are when there's no chance of getting caught. That's character. Living for God, serving the Lord. Then you have to have a good relationship with God and good relationship with your family. How many of you know it's important, husband, that you have a good relationship with your wife and your children? Wife, it's important that your relationship with your husband and your family is good. That's, and with God. I read in my Bible, and he said yours too, that Joseph was the highest ranking servant in Pharaoh's palace. He had the highest rank of anyone there. He was the NCO of Egypt. He had the highest rank. Pharaoh's wife did everything she could to get him. Let me tell you something. The enemy has got something out there that he'll throw at you to get you. It may not be a woman or it may not be another man, but he's got something out there to entice you and to tempt you. The way she dressed, she was trying to entice Joseph. I'm glad the kids are next door. The perfume she wore, it was to try to entice Joseph. Why do you think Jezebel painted her face, put on her, I started to say best, but I guess the sexiest thing she had, fixed her hair, put her jewelry on. Now I got Bible for this. She took her head out the window and hollered at Jehu the prophet. She was trying to entice him, just like Potiphar's wife What did Brother Tenney call her? Polly?
Polly.
Polly Potiphar. The way she dressed, what the perfume she wore, the way she moved herself around him, trying to entice him to the bedroom. It's all, this is Bible. I'm in the scripture. This needs to be heard. It needs to be taught. After all, a beautiful, sexy woman in the bedroom of the palace could have been a terrible temptation for Joseph. But what did Joseph do? The Bible said he ran from the palace. He ran and got away. The very first thing we ought to do when temptation comes is run.
Yeah. Right.
The first thing we ought to do, Brother Crumb, when we feel that temptation is run from it. Get away from anything or anybody. That's why I try to teach our young people, you shouldn't even consider. They don't listen to me. And a lot of them get in trouble. You should not even consider dating someone out of the apostolic church if you're going to be apostolic. Shouldn't even consider. It shouldn't even be talked about. Many people have not heed that advice. I hear it all the time. I'm gonna marry him and get him in church. It ain't like it. Not like it. Oh, I'm going to marry her preacher, you know, and she's going to come and she's going to be a partner. No, she's not. Make her come, make him come and be a part for about 3 years first. Many people don't listen to it. Joseph knew when the fun was over, so would his relationship with God be. And he knew that. The person who loves the Lord does not operate from the principle of can I get away with it? Or how much pleasure will it give me? Instead, we should be asking the question, is this pleasing to God? Would God approve it? Would God say it's okay? If God wouldn't approve it, why would I approve it? If God wouldn't go there, why would I want to go there? If God wouldn't talk that, why would I want to talk that? Amen. Temptation is tied to the fact that it's tied to what we see and what we think. In the Garden of Eden, the fruit was pleasant to the Eve's eye. She looked so long. The more she looked, the more excited she got. Her thoughts became more excited. When she should have walked away, she didn't. When she should have got away from it, she never did. She looked, she lusted, and she partook of it. As Satan would tempt her with it. I don't know what kind of fruit it was. I joke around. I always say it ain't the apple, it's the pear. On the ground. That's as close as I can get to it. I don't know what kind of fruit it was. I don't know if it was a literal tree. I think it was. I don't know if it was the temptation. But I do know that she looked, she lusted. Instead of running from it, she partook of it. Sin's always in the mind before it becomes an action. You think about it. She looked. The more she looked, the more excited about it she got. Lustful thoughts. Somebody said it like this, are a forerunner of lustful behavior. It's a thought first. Got to get it in your mind and think about it. Selfish thoughts is a forerunner of selfish behavior. You'll always think about it. It'll be your thoughts before it becomes action. Sooner or later, watch this now, our behavior will conform to our thoughts. Our thoughts will become reality.
Right.
If you think about it long enough, it becomes easy. I said it the other night. I believe it was Wednesday night or Sunday night. I believe I said this. It may have been Wednesday night. I can't recall. I guess it was Wednesday night. The more you sin, the easier it is to sin. And the worse sin becomes. It's like drinking. I can say this because I'm an old boozer, see. I can tell you this. When I started drinking, I hated that junk. It tastes terrible. Lord, I don't know how anybody could have drank a can of beer. It was the worst tasted junk I've ever put in my mouth. But I drank enough of it, I got used to it. I drank it because my friends drank it. Mm-hmm. My buddies drank it. The one people we hung out with, that's what you did. You sat on the hood of the car out here, Merritt's or the drive-in, and you sat on the hood of the car and drank beer. Usually enough to get off the hood. But you hated it. But the more you drank, the better it tasted. And then it became easier. I knew when I started drinking, Bucky, and I shouldn't do that. Number one, I knew I had to drive home. I knew better. I'd been taught better. But I just didn't do any better. Till finally one night, I'm going to Memphis. I was up here at Covington. I was living in Memphis at Bartlett with my sister before I married. I was driving a 65 Pontiac. This was in 67. Man, that thing would run. What you talking about? A scalded dog. Had a bucket seat, forward floor. Man, I could slip a case in all four gears. Until I started buying cases. Then I quit slipping cases. I'm going down 14 Highway, drunker and cooler brown. I had to go to work the next day. This was Friday night, late Friday night, probably early Saturday morning. I'm going toward Bartlett, trying to get home, because I got to go to work at 7 o'clock. And all of a sudden, I guess I'm asleep, and the car's bouncing, and I open my eyes, and the weeds and briars and bushes were up high to the hood of the car, and I'm running the opposite side of 14 Highway on the shoulder, just a flying. Thank God there wasn't a bridge bouncer. Something there. And I woke up. Don't you ever think I didn't? I turned that steering wheel, got that car back on the road, and slowed down and found me a wire spot and pulled over and got regrouped myself, and I was sober.
I bet he was.
I knew better than that. I knew better than that. See, I was taught different. Are you ready? But the more I done it, the easier it became to do it. My wife will tell you, when I first started drinking after we got married, after I quit drinking, I got in church. I never had the Holy Ghost, but I did get in church. I got in church because she was in church, and that's why I went, because I wanted her, and I got her. Praise the Lord. Went in the army, went crazy as a Betsy bug. Tried to drink everything at Fort Campbell and Fort Polk, Louisiana, and then tried to drink everything in Okinawa, Japan. Come home, drinking. But my wife would tell you, when I would come home, I would stop and get me a can of beer from work. Maybe a couple of nights a week. But then it got to where I'd buy more. And then if I didn't have whatever it was that can of beer cost, I would borrow the money from a work buddy to buy me a can of beer to get home. Then I got where I'd buy a six-pack. Then I'd stop on Friday afternoon, buy two six-packs. And go to the liquor store, cash the check, buy a half pint of whiskey. Are you understanding? The more I did it, the more easier it became. That's the way sin is. The more you do it, the easier. Sooner or later, your behavior will go to what you're thinking. That's the point I'm trying to make. And we have to learn to overcome those kind of thoughts. I'm fishing, let you go home here in about another half hour. When David saw Bathsheba, he did not walk away.
Right.
Now the Bible don't say, Brother Jim, whether this was the first time David ever seen her on that rooftop or not. I don't know. He saw her out on that rooftop bathing herself. She was a beautiful, beautiful lady according to the scripture. David, even though he was king, had no business confronting that woman.
Amen.
That woman belonged to another man.
Yeah, right.
that other man was out in the battle fighting for David.
Right, right.
And David's at home committing adultery with his wife.
Right.
She became pregnant. David's thoughts, David's actions, that temptation that David went through, destroyed the life of a good and an innocent man.
Right.
He done that to hide what he had done.
That's right.
Destroyed a great man.
Right.
The person who allows temptation and lustful thoughts to take refuge in their mind will sooner or later be overtaken by them.
Right. Right.
This is what happened to King David. The Bible says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. A wise person will stay as far away from temptation as he can. I don't care what they call you. I don't care if they call you a weakling, or if they call you a sissy. Of course, nobody here gets it in school. But whatever it is they call you, a wise person that's got character and got a good relationship will stay as far away from problems of such that I'm preaching about here tonight as they possibly can.
All right. Yes, sir.
I think my wife told you the story at Sunday school here a few months back. I know she did. I stood back there and listened to the story, made sure she told it right. We left church one night. We went by her brother's house. Well, her brother and I drank a lot together before I got in church. So we went in. It's after service on Sunday night. They're all sitting around drinking Coke. I thought it was Coke. And he had bourbon in it. Bourbon and Coke. And somebody asked me, said, do y'all want a Coke? And I said, yeah. I was thirsty. So he speaks up and says, take mine. I've not even drank out of it. I don't even want it. He didn't tell me that he had it about half and half. Okay? Here I am, and I grabbed it, thirsty, and I just went to chug a little. Well, it hit my mouth, and I had tasted that taste before, and it was whiskey. But the joke was on him, because I spit it right in his floor. I never swallowed it. You've got to run. It don't matter what they call you. He can call you a wimp, a weakling. Oh, you can't this, you can't that. I don't care what it is they say. You need to run from temptation as soon as you recognize what it is. Praise the Lord. A person has to stay away from it. People learn the consequences of it too late. People learn they learn the effects of lust and temptation too late in life. Many times they do. They learn what alcohol, whiskey, cigarettes, so on. They learn the effects that has on their body and on their family way too late. Many people do in life. And then all they can do, now you hear me, all they can do then, now they can make it right with God, may make it right with your companion. Everything may be okay. But all you can do then is sit down at night and wish it never had happened.
All right. Yes, sir.
But it had happened.
Right.
I hope I'm catching talking to somebody.
Yes,
that is the power of temptation. The power of lust. You know, I read an article in one of our magazines, Brother Jim. And then I read that article somewhere else, but I can't recall where it was now. This is what the article said in so many words. It said, when a young person gets a pornography, a porno magazine, or a porno movie, and watches it. I'm talking about hard porno, hard stuff. 20 minutes, they're hooked on it for life. Said it's worse than cocaine. People learn that way too late in life. Somebody ought to teach this every week. Somebody ought to tell us every, somebody ought to tell our young people every week the effects that sin and lust and temptation and drinking and gambling and smoking and all this kind of stuff, the effect that it has on their life. Not to mention what it does to their body. I was walking down the street. No, I was in Walmart. I went over there to get some light, a light for me. A sign out front, or not the sign, but the post out there by the road so y'all won't run the ditch. And I walk in back, I checked out, way down, and I come out, I'm headed down. And I can't remember how many people I met that I knew what their problem was because of the cord they had around their neck. They had it in their nose. And I'm not being critical. If I offend you, please forgive me. I don't mean it that way. I've had people tell me, Brother Gillum and I went to a place one night at Broad Meadows. Yeah, Broad Meadows. We were asked to come out there and pray for a lady. We went out there and she couldn't hardly talk. She stopped up from cigarettes and had oxygen on and had a two or three packs of cigarettes laid on the coffee table and an ashtray that big around, plumb full, running over with cigarette butts and wanting me to pray that God would touch her breathing. And she told me, she said, Preacher, she said, I know what I've done to myself, that I've done it myself, but I can't quit. Learn it way too late in life. Way too late. And all they can say then, I wished I hadn't done it. I wish somebody had told me when I was a kid. I wish had not happened as it did. They learned way too late in life. Sister Creasy, will you play that piano? Just don't wait too late in life. Draw you some boundaries. Establish some good moral and spiritual boundaries by praying in an altar. 119:11 of Psalms. Brother Michael, please, sir. 119:11 of Psalms. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Get in the word of God. Joshua 1 and verse 8. Brother Michael, please. You don't mind, sir? Joshua 1 and 8. Praise the Lord. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. Above all, we must be an overcomer. We must overcome the temptations of life. Just because we've got the Holy Ghost preaching, teaching, running the aisles, singing, and worshiping God does not mean temptation does not come our way. We have to be an overcomer. We have to draw the boundary. It stops right here. I'm not moving another step. Stand with me. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. While she sings, come in. Join me around the altar. Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord.
Draw me nearer.
like a ship without a sail. Jesus, Jesus.
to us. Ain't the Lord good to us? Hallelujah. The Lord's good. Stand to your feet and just lift your hands and love Him just for a minute. Lord, just we love You. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for being here tonight. Appreciate everyone for being. Appreciate young brother here coming to the altar. You ought to be able to call your name, okay?
That's Cody.
Cody?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I knew who you was. I just couldn't put that. I guess it's called experience. Yeah, it's been a long time. We're glad you're here tonight, son. Live for the Lord with all your heart, mind, and strength. Things about it. Going to have church again Sunday, just running as hard as we can run, giving it all we got. You're running out of time, Brother Willingham. If we're going to touch our generation, we better touch them now. Amen. The devil's touching them. The world's touching them. It's up to the church to counteract, counterattack. Praise God. Brother Mark gave me some advice or some information today that stunned me and really put me to thinking. He said, Brother Creasy, we're running a race with the world. And the world's winning. So the world is outdoing us. We better get busy, ladies and gentlemen. We better get busy. We better start doing more praying, more worshiping, more seeking God. Amen. Come back Sunday and believe the Lord for a great move of God. Hallelujah.
We got a cousin in ICU.
It's
all right, let's pray for that. Let's pray for that. It's okay. For that family. Okay. All right. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you tonight for the Word of God, for the Spirit of the Holy Ghost, for our young brother tonight, Lord, that was at this altar. God, give him a touch, Lord, like he's never had before. Touch these that are sick, the one that's in intensive care. God, touch that family to that one that passed away. Build a hedge about us, Lord. Go with us to our home. Keep us safe. Bring us back Sunday in the name of Jesus. Everybody say amen.